Hello, dear learners. Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Jaseem Ahmed from IASC, Faculty of Education, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Today, we will discuss about educational implications of learning theories with specific reference to memory, forgetting, transfer of learning, comprehension, and insight. This comes under the paper Psychology of Learning and Development. So, dear students, after studying this module, you would be able to, number one, describe the educational implications of learning theories with reference to memory and forgetting. Number two, describe the educational implications of learning theories with reference to the transfer of learning. Number three, discuss the implications of learning theories with reference to comprehension and insight. Dear students, let's start with memory. Memory refers to the encoding, storage, and retrieval of information. A number of theories of memory have been proposed. In one of these, memory is said to consist of the three cognitive processes as mentioned in its definition, that is encoding, storage, and retrieval. Encoding is the process of receiving sensory inputs, and retrieval is the process of gaining access to the encoded stored information when it is to be used. Dear students, let's talk about the stages of memory. Memory is classified into the following three stages. Number one is sensory memory, number two is short-term memory, and number three is long-term memory. Sensory memory holds sensory information for a few seconds, has a relatively large capacity, stores a copy of the sensory input, and loses information through a process involving the decay of the memory trace. Items in the sensory register that are attended to and recognized may be passed on to short-term memory. The short-term memory holds a relatively small amount of information for a smaller duration of time. The type of information stored in short-term memory consists of sounds, images, words, or sentences. Any stored information is lost from short-term memory on being displaced by new inputs. It may be transferred to long-term memory through either maintenance or elaborative rehearsal. In long-term memory, information lasts for the days, months, years, or even for a lifetime. The capacity of long-term memory has no known limits. Episodic and the semantic memories are stored in long-term memory. Information may be lost or at least not retrieved from long-term memory. Because of difficulties with the search process or because of interference by other long-term memories. Students, when we talk about memory, it is usually long-term memory that we have in our mind. Here, information is well organized, categorized, and classified like a library with a good cross-indexing system. Let's talk about behaviorism and memory. Memory, as commonly defined by a layman, is not typically addressed by behaviorists. Although the acquisition of habits is discussed, but little attention is given as to how these habits are stored or recalled for future use. Forgetting is attributed to the non-use of response over time. The use of periodic practice or review serves to maintain a learner's readiness to respond. Dear learners, let's move to cognitivism and memory. Cognitivism refers to the study of the mind and how it obtains, processes, and stores information. It is argued that not all learning occurs through shaping and changing of behaviors. In this theory, learners are active participants in their learning, and the mind functions like a computer processor. Information comes in an input, the mind processes the information for the time being, and the information is stored away to be retrieved later. Learning is shaped by a variety of learning strategies and with the help of prior knowledge and attitudes called schemas. Contents needs to be presented in an organized manner for most efficient learning. Dear students, now let's look at constructivism and memory. The goal of instruction is not to ensure that individuals know particular facts, but rather they elaborate on and interpret information. As quoted by Brown et al., understanding is developed through continued, situated use and does not crystallize into a categorical definition that can be called up from memory. A concept will continue to evolve with each new use as new situation. Negotiations and activities recast it in different, more densely textured form. Therefore, memory is always under construction as a cumulative history of interactions. Representations of experiences are not formalized or structured into a single piece of declarative knowledge and then stored in the head. The emphasis is not on retrieving intact knowledge structures, but on providing learners with the means to create novel and situation-specific understandings by assembling prior knowledge from diverse sources appropriate to the problem at hand. Dear students, constructivists emphasize the flexible use of pre-existing knowledge rather than the recall of pre-packaged schemas. To be successful, meaningful, and lasting, learning must include all three of these crucial factors, that is, number one, activity, that is practice, number two, concept, that is knowledge, and number three, culture, that is context. Dear students, now let's talk about learning theories and memory and the implications for educational practice. Learning can be defined as any relatively permanent change in behavior that occurs as a result of practice or experience. If we look into the different developmental stages of the learning theories, we find that in order to overcome the drawbacks of one approach, a new approach of learning has been developed with its own drawback. A teacher can use various approaches to improve learning and strengthen memorization, like learners should be made aware about the objectives of the lesson so that they can attend to the information throughout the lesson. Number two, information critical for learning should be highlighted to focus learners' attention. Number three, the difficulty level of the material must match the cognitive level of the learner so that the learner can both attend to and relate to the material. Links to both simpler and more complicated materials can be used to accommodate learners at different knowledge levels. Strategies should be used to allow learners to retrieve existing information from long-term memory to help make sense of the new information. Learners must construct a memory link between the new information and some related information already stored in long-term memory. Information should be chunked to prevent overload during processing in working memory. To facilitate deep processing, learners should be asked to generate the information maps during the learning process or as a summary activity after the lesson is over. Strategies that promote deep processing should be used to help transfer information to long-term storage. Applying, analyzing, and evaluating are such strategies that promote higher-level learning and makes the transfer to long-term memory more effective. Dear students, now let's discuss one of the most common thing related to memory and forgetting and their educational implications. Memory and forgetting are complementary to each other. Both are essential and have their own significance. Something is needed to be memorized and others needed to be forgotten and vice versa. Forgetting, its causes and its educational implications can be understood under the subtopics interference and retrieval problem. Let's first talk about interference. A vast amount of experimental evidences as well as everyday experiences indicate that learning new things interfere with our memory of what we have learned earlier. It is because of interference among various memories, technically memory interference resulting from activities that happen later or subsequent to the events you are trying to remember is called retroactive interference. It is called retroactive because the interference is with the memory of events that came before the interfering activity. Proactive interference, on the other hand, is due to events that came before the to-be-remembered information. Let's talk about retrieval problem. The retrieval is facilitated by organization of the stored material and the presence of retrieval cues that can guide our search through our long-term memory for stored information. Without appropriate retrieval cues, the sought for items stored in long-term memory may not be found. Dear students, when we cannot recall something while actively searching for it, generally we give up. And we may later recall the sought for information when we have given up the search and are doing something else. The new activity or context in which we are engaged gives us another set of appropriate reminders or retrieval cues, and perhaps the new situation leads us to search through various portions of our long-term memory store not examined before. The result may be that we suddenly remember what we could not previously retrieve. Thus, when we think we have forgotten something, it is often a good idea to give up and do something else in order to generate new retrieval cues. Emotional factors can also play a role in the retrieval failure that is the cause of some forgetting. If we encode information while in one emotional state and try to retrieve it while in another, our recall may suffer. Students, let's look at motivated forgetting. In his classic book, The Psychopathology of Everyday Life, Sigmund Freud, 1951, clearly mentioned that forgetting in all cases is proved to be founded on a motive of displeasure. Students, Freud hints at the key concept of repression, which refers to the tendency of people to have difficulty retrieving anxiety-provoking or threatening information from long-term memory. This helps to explain why people generally remember pleasant events more often than they do unpleasant ones. The unpleasant memories are repressed. Many lapses of memory in daily life illustrate motivated forgetting. For example, you may forget to do something from your day schedule for which you were not motivated. You do not forget the name of the people you like the most. To dig up unconscious and repressed memories, psychoanalysts use the method of free association, that is, making an individual say whatever comes to his or her mind. Free association perhaps works in part because in the process of doing it, retrieval cues for the repressed memories are generated. Hypnosis and various drugs called truth serums are also used with occasional success to retrieve repressed information not available to consciousness in the normal waking state. Learners, let's move to amnesia, a term used to refer loss of memory. A kind of forgetting, indeed some forms of memory disorder in which an individual loses the ability to retrieve stored information. The term amnesia is also used for cases in which encoding and storage are impaired so that new memories cannot be formed. It may be because of disturbance in brain called as biological amnesia. Others may be called as psychological amnesia, in which without any known brain malfunction, major disturbances in the process of information encoding, storage and retrieval is observed. Students, now we discuss about transfer of learning. In simple terms, transfer of learning is defined broadly as the carryover of knowledge, skill, thinking or attitude and habits from one learning situation to another. It exerts a powerful influence over the degree of success which an individual attains in solving problems of adjustment and in all the experiences that constitute his daily reactions to people, things, and situations. We should also keep in mind that there are levels and types of transfer, like positive and negative transfer. When learning in one context improves learning or performance in another context, this is called positive transfer. For example, learning of the concept atom helps in learning the concept molecule. Negative transfer occurs when previous learning or experiences inhibits or interferes with learning or performance in a new context. For example, tourists accustomed to driving on the right-hand side of the road experience difficulty adjusting to driving on the left-hand side in New Zealand and Australia. The next classification is simple and complex transfer. Simple transfer happens when little or no effort is required to apply what has been learned in one situation to a new situation. For example, when students are taught how to use a spreadsheet to create a budget, and later they create a budget for their own educational trip using a spreadsheet easily. On the contrary, if the same students were engaged in gathering data for a research project and thought about the ways in which the spreadsheet program could assist with the data management and analysis, this would be an example of more complex transfer. Now, let's discuss about near and far transfer. These transfers depends upon the closeness or distance between the original learning and the new learning task. For example, learning to shift gears in a heavy vehicle is an example of near transfer for someone who has already learned to shift gears in small cars. Near transfer is also seen as the transfer of learning within the school context or between a school task and a similar task done at home. For example, when students answer similar questions in test to those they have practiced at home or in class. Far transfer is used to refer to the transfer of learning from one context to a different new context. For example, a skill learned in economics classes may be used in making investment decision is an example of far transfer. Now we talk about automatic and mindful transfer. When an individual responds spontaneously within a transfer situation, which is very similar to the learning situation, then it is called as automatic transfer. For instance, learning to read English in classes results in the learner automatically reading English newspaper. In contrast, mindful transfer is deliberate and involves conscious thought and intellectual effort. Mindful transfer occurs in situations where there are significant gaps or differences between the original and the new transfer situations. Dear students, now let's talk about enhancing transfer between school and everyday life. The National Research Council in 2000 states that the ultimate goal of transfer is for students to generalize the knowledge they have learned in school to practice in daily life activities such as at home, in community and at workplace. In order to promote transfer to non-school environment, NRC has provided guidelines for educators to better understand the needed skill for students to succeed in new situations. Now, we try to look into the concept of collaboration. Students need exposure to various types of collaborative projects in order to better transfer their knowledge to non-classroom environments. This demands, number one, the use of tools. The use of tools increased students' exposure to application of relevant tools and techniques, such as use of ICT tools and other technologies, enhances transfer in variety of settings. Number two, contextualized reasoning. Abstract reasoning is primarily reinforced in a school, for example, the use of mathematical formulas. In outside the school setting, such as the shopping mall, people often use contextualized reasoning to solve various problems. Many adults are able to choose either context-based or abstract-based reasoning to cater to their specific needs. Students should be given opportunity to use both types of reasoning. Dear learners, let's explore the implications for educational practice of transfer of learning. Teachers can help students transfer learning not just between context in academics, but also to common homework or community environments. We as teachers need to keep in mind some important points to make the learning joyful so that transfer of learning becomes effective. These points may be, number one, have clear-cut objectives. Number two, decide what students should be able to do as a result of their work. Number three, study the course content to find what it contains that is applicable to other school subjects and to out of school life. Ensure this as far as possible. Number four, select instructional materials which are best suited and may be integrated with practical situations. Number 5, let students know when to expect transfer, what kind to expect, and the benefits which it can bring to them. Number 6, use methods of teaching, example, problem solving, discussion method, leading questions, which will facilitate transfer of learning. Number 7, provide opportunity for practice of transfer. It is not enough to point out relationship. Pupils should be given chance for finding relationship on their own. Tests of application, guided discussion, and actual class projects ought to provide this kind of experiences. Number 8, concentrate on the process of learning as well as upon products. Do not satisfy with a right answer or solution, but probe to find out why a certain answer or solution was given and discuss with the steps which led to the answer. Let's have a glance at the concept and meaning of comprehension and insight. There are 3 levels of learning. First is knowledge level, second is understanding or comprehension level, and the third one is reflective level. Comprehension level of learning means the learner has understood the basic idea of the concept and he is able to explain, describe, analyze, and synthesize that particular concept on his own. He is able to develop and describe the relationship between various elements of that particular concept and their association with other related concepts. The process of comprehension develops the insight in the learner through which he moves from the level of merely cramming and recalling the learning facts or concepts or principle or theory or laws with regard to any subject to explain, elaborate, describe, and give his reflection on his learning. Without comprehension, reading is empty and meaningless. We experience the cases where students are capable of reading the words but face much difficulty in expressing their comprehension of the main ideas. A child may love to read but have difficulty in comprehending what he read. The child may eagerly read to an audience since he had a solid grasp of phonemic awareness, that is, sounding out words, and social discourses, reading with expression. He may appear to be a strong reader, but may be unable to demonstrate comprehension of the reading material. As educators, we need to have an understanding of the theories behind comprehension as well as a working knowledge of some important strategies that can be used in the classroom to increase comprehension among learners. Let's explore some strategies to improve comprehension and insight. These may be number 1, setting goals for learning. Learner learns to ask themselves what I have to do and why am I learning this. Number 2, focusing attention. Learners learn to prompt themselves with questions such as what am I supposed to do as I learn. Number 3, self-reinforcement. Learner learns to say to them, great, I understand this, keep up the good work, or this strategy really works. Number 4, coping with problems. When they encounter difficulties, learners learn to say to them, I don't understand this, I should go back and try again. According to Katims 1997, learning strategies are techniques or routines that enable students to learn to solve problems and complete tasks independently. A strategy is an individual's approach to a task. Gunning in 1996 identifies 4 main types of comprehension strategies, which include preparational, number 1, number 2, organizational, number 3, elaboration, and number 4 is monitoring. Students, let's discuss about preparational first. Gunning describes preparational strategies as those that activate prior knowledge about a particular topic. This method is used to get students thinking about the topic they are about to work on. It is much easier to retain knowledge about a subject when this student is familiar with the subject area. Now, moving to the second type of strategy, that is organizational. Gunning describes organizational strategies as the process of selecting important details and building relationship among them. These strategies include identifying the main idea and topic, classifying information, deciding which information is relevant, sequencing, and summarizing. Each of these strategies is complex, and methods for improving them need to be taught, starting from basic ideas and gradually getting more difficult. Summarizing, in particular, has been identified as a difficult skill to develop. The third type of strategy is elaboration. Gunning refers to elaboration as an additional processing of the concept by the learner, which may increase comprehension. It involves forming connections between the concept and the learner's previous experiences and background knowledge of the subject. Making inferences, picturizing images, and asking questions are all types of elaboration strategies. Huffman, in 1998, identifies KWL as an elaboration strategy which connects background knowledge to the topic to be addressed. KWL is an acronym for the three steps of the procedure, describing what we know, what we want to know, and what we learned. The first two steps are complete before the project has begun, to assess background information, and the third step is completed afterward to make the connections. Let's discuss the last strategy, that is monitoring. Gunning defines monitoring as being aware of one's own mental processes when learning is going on. Monitoring is an advanced technique that involves a great deal of independent thinking. Monitoring occurs when a learner is aware that he does not understand what he was trying. The act of monitoring knows how to go back and find way to gain understanding of that particular topic. Dear learners, now let's summarize our today's topic. We talked about memory, forgetting, transfer of learning, comprehension, and cognition. All these are very important and inter-influential and interdependent processes of education and training. They depend on the quality of teaching and learning. Dear students, remember, more is the quality of teaching and training, more effective will be the learning on the part of the learners, and more it will influence the memory, transfer of learning, and cognition by students. We, as teachers, need to plan our teaching more skillfully, activity-based, using constructivist approach to have far-reaching impact on the learning and achievement of the young minds. Thank you so much.